really excited to be here because I think this is an important day announcing the Kids Count report, which, as Seal mentioned at the top of the conversation, really sets forth, I think, a really sobering reality about the conditions that so many of our young folks face, particularly here in the city of Newark. And what I wanted to do was talk a bit about how I think these findings are part of a broader system of racial discrimination that dates back to the institution of slavery. So folks know that this is 2019. This is the 400th anniversary of Black people's arrival in Jamestown, Virginia. And historians say that Black folks actually came to this country sooner, some say in the 1500s to Florida, but we know that in mid-August of 1619, about 20 or so Black folks made their way to Jamestown, Virginia. And it's interesting because 400 years later, New Jersey has some of the starkest racial disparities in the country. Those have been highlighted in the report today, focusing in part on Newark. But you see these throughout New Jersey. So New Jersey, as you all know well, is every year one of the wealthiest states in America. In New Jersey, the median net worth for New Jersey's white families is $309,000. Last year, it was $271,000. This year, the median net worth for New Jersey's white families is $309,000. And you know that there's a difference between income and worth. So worth is what happens when you run out of income and you can rely on your wealth. But there's a staggering and really shameful contrast when we look at Black and Latino families and their median net worth. For Latino families, the median net worth for them is $7,200. And for Black families, the median net wealth is $5,900. In one of the wealthiest states in America, we have incredible prosperity alongside really punishing poverty. And the report talks a good bit about the youth justice system. You know, you don't have to go to the southern border of the United States to perceive a situation where Black and brown kids are torn from their families and caged. You see, that happens right here in New Jersey at staggering rates. New Jersey is a state that in the last 10 years has reduced its overall prison population, the adult prison population, the youth justice prison population, by 50%. Significant reduction in the overall prison population. But even as the prison population has fallen by 50%, racial disparities have exploded so that today New Jersey leads the country in having the highest Black to white adult and youth incarceration disparity rate. For adults, it's 12 to 1. For young people, young Black kids, it's 30 to 1, which is to say, put differently, that a Black child in New Jersey is 30 times more likely to be incarcerated than a white child, even though research shows that Black and white kids commit most offenses at about the same rate. And New Jersey spends an extraordinary amount of money in this failed experiment. 2 years ago, New Jersey spent $250,000 to incarcerate each child in prison. In this year's budget, just released by the governor, New Jersey will spend $290,000 to incarcerate each child. Can you imagine what you could do were you to invest $290,000 each year in the life of a young person? And so these things we grapple with really are structural challenges that go back to the very founding of the institution of slavery. Before the conversation began, I had a chance to talk to our moderators, who will talk to our fancy guests, the mayor who's just arrived, our superintendent, and Aisha Glover from the Newark Alliance. And I asked Dionysus, you know, in light of sort of where we are in this moment, can you offer for me a word that sort of captures how you feel now? And he talked a bit about how the report offers some really sobering statistics, a very difficult reality. But he said, I think about those things and I think about this word, which is growth. He said, a couple of years ago, you couldn't have filled this room with these fancy folks to talk about us, young people. He said, I've been very inspired by the mayor's reference to certain cultures who greet each other by saying, how are the children? And so he says, I think about that in today's conversation. How are the children? And I think that for me, Dionysus August, a writer, a poet, a speaker, an inspirational person, someone who's seriously considering law school. Isn't that right? I'm putting this out there in front of everybody. That the word that captures this moment for him is his growth. And Manuel Mejia, his co-moderator, when asked the same question, how do you feel about this particular moment in light of all that we see? Yes, the challenges, but also, yes, the opportunities. What captures this moment for you in a word? And he said, you know, for me, the word is exposure. Yes, exposure to the challenges, but also exposure to the opportunities in front of us, literally. And so I'm excited that this conversation is being led by young people, for young people, and about young people. And before I bring them up, I want to say that I'm excited that we are here today focusing on, yes, challenges, but also how do we face down those challenges with significant opportunities. My Brother's Keeper, Newark Initiative, is overseen by a board of trustees that include me, that include Ron Chaloisin from the Newark Trust, that include the mayor from the city, that include Prudential Foundation, and also includes Robert Clark, who is the founder of the Lee Charter School. Rob is also the founder of Youth Build Newark and of the OYN Opportunity Youth Network. And I'm excited to say that after meeting for about a year or so, My Brother's Keeper Newark will now be housed in OYN. Which is a significant move because so much of what OYN does, serving our young people, aligns so nicely with My Brother's Keeper's passion, vision, and purpose. So now I bring to you our heroes, Dionysus August, who's going to be going to law school very soon, and his co-moderator, Manuel Mejia.